verbally assaulted throughout the Bay Area. In Richmond, members of the mosque Al-Rahman were threatened. On December 6, 2015, while praying at Lake Chabot, Rashid Al-Busari and his friends were verbally and physically assaulted for being Muslims. Will we tolerate this in the Bay Area?
No.
Will we stand against Islamophobic attacks?
Yes.
The people united will never be defeated.
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 Defeated, divided, you know, they're interchangeable. First off, I would like to introduce John Avalos, U.S. Board of Supervisors, to come speak on the mic. He's been a very supportive person in our community, and we'd like to thank him for that, so please give him a round of applause, John Avalos. Thank you. I actually did not have anything prepared yet to say, except that I have been so outraged at the vitriol that the Muslim Arab community has been experiencing, not just recently, although there's been a huge uptick recently, but over decades. I've grown up in this country, born and raised in the United States, lived in different places in this country, and there's just been a huge disconnect to people's attitudes about Muslim and Arab people in this country, completely ignoring what role our country plays around the world in disrupting the lives of people in the Eastern Mediterranean and Southwest Asia and other parts of the world. And our country does so much that creates the destabilization in countries, that leads to people being refugees, that are being denied access into this country, that also breeds the kind of hate that our hate contributes to, and that we don't understand. We actually need to understand what's happening in this world and how our actions contribute to the lack of safety we experience here in this country. And I have to actually put a word in about just how our politics are completely distorted. When police officers commit what look like acts of terrorism, they're actually supported and protected. And when people are so quick to jump to anything that happens on our streets to say that this was done by Muslim people, there's not a real sense of how our country could be made in a better place. I want to thank everyone for actually being here and protesting and standing up for the rights of Muslim people. I really hadn't prepared myself the way I had wanted to. But this is a time when we actually come together. And we come together in a time of peace. That's what the holidays are about. And we're not, and this is coming together to support people who are most oppressed in this country at this time, and I stand in solidarity. Thank you.
Thank you. He has inspired me to feel strong in the face of hate speech, to feel powerful in the face of surveillance and racist chain voting. I am unapologetically Muslim. I am proud to be part of this ecology of social justice activists that show up for one another. We have a long history of supporting one another and inspiring each other, challenging each other to see how our struggles intersect. We haven't forgotten NCERS, that Department of Justice program requiring that certain individuals from certain countries present themselves for questioning and special registration. We resisted NCERS through Know Your Rights programs and training and collaborative support. We testified together here at City Hall in front of Human Rights Commission hearings so that the social, psychological, and economic impact of racial profiling and surveillance was clear and documented. We hold our city officials accountable. accountable through relentless organizing to oppose new programs like Stop and Frisk. ASATA members are ready to continue this work with all of you. Thank you so much.
Area!
Unite, unite, unite!
Muslims!
Unite!
Arabs!
Unite!
The whole Bay Area!
Unite, unite, unite!
Muslims!
United!
Arabs!
United!
The whole Bay Area!
Unite, unite, unite!
All right. In the Bay Area, the so-called counterterrorism exercise federal program, Urban Shield, will continue to justify the government's massive surveillance and militarization on the basis of national security. This national security has affected all communities of color and has particularly targeted Muslim communities abroad, here and abroad as well. Next up, I would like to introduce Shakir, who is going to give an introduction to AROC and the work that we do in Arabic. Thank you. Please put your hands together for Shakir.
بأننا نرفض هذه الممارسات العنصرية تجاه أهلنا وشعبنا تجاه العرب تجاه المسلمين هون في أمريكا وفي كل بلاد العالم. الرسالة اللي لازم نوصلها إنه إحنا متحدين وإنه إحنا لا يمكن أبداً أن نسكت في حال تم الاعتداء على أي شخص من العرب والمسلمين أو أي شخص مضطهد في الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية من شعبنا وأهلنا المقيمين فيها. هذه الممارسات ليست جديدة، مستمرة من عشرات السنوات. استمرت من عشرات السنوات من سيء إلى أسوأ في دولة تدعي يومياً بأنها أم الديمقراطيات. في دولة تدعي يومياً بأنها أم العلمانية والمواطنة. العلمانية التي تستثني الناس على أساس دينهم، هذه علمانية مريضة. المواطنة التي تستثني الناس على أساس العرق وعلى أساس اللون وعلى أساس الدين، هذه مواطنة الأغنياء وأصحاب النفوذ وأصحاب المنافع. ترامب ليس حالة فردية. جنين بيرو ليست حالة فردية. هؤلاء وراهم أجهزة إعلامية وشركات تضخ في الملايين هذا الخطاب التحريضي العنصري. هؤلاء ليسوا حالة فردية على الإطلاق. لكن ما يقوله ترامب وما يقوله آلاء العنصريون هو مؤشر إلى أي حد وصلت هذه الديمقراطية الأمريكية، إلى أي حد من الانحطاط والقرف وصلت هذه الديمقراطية الأمريكية. عندما تتحول حياة الناس ومصائرهم ومستقبلهم إلى شعار انتخابي، فهذه ديمقراطية مريضة، فهذه ديمقراطية مقرفة. أن تتحول حياة الناس إلى شعار انتخابي، هذه هي الديمقراطية؟ أن نحرض على قتل الناس، هذه هي الديمقراطية؟ أن نحرض على طرد المكسيكان والعرب والمسلمين تحت شعار حرية التعبير؟ إخواني، علينا أن نرفض سؤالنا عن داعش. لا أحد يحق له أن يسألنا نحن عن داعش. اسأل الحكومة الأمريكية عن داعش. اسم الحروب التي خاضتها امريكا في العراق وفي افغانستان وفي كل مكان عن داعش. اسم الحكومة الامريكية عن داعش. اسم السجون التي فتحتها امريكا في كل العالم. اسم غوانتانامو. اسم سجن بوكا. اسم ابو غريب. اسمهم عن داعش. لا تسألوننا نحن عن داعش. نحن اكثر المتضررين من داعش وغير داعش. نحن عانينا الويلات من الحروب الإمبريالية التي خاضتها أمريكا ومن الدكتاتوريات العربية التي دعمتها أمريكا ومن داعش التي بشكل من الأشكال هي نتيجة هذه السياسات الإمبريالية والدكتاتوريات العربية التي تدعمها أمريكا. نرفض أن تسألوننا عن داعش رفضا مطلقا. داعش، لمن يريد أن يعرف داعش، عليه أن يسأل جورج بوش، عليه أن يسأل ترامب، عليه أن يسأل الحكومة الأمريكية، لا أن يسأل العرب والمسلمين. وشكرا.
All right, y'all, let's do some chanting. Dignity.
liberation, self-determination, dignity, liberation, self-determination, dignity, liberation, self-determination, dignity, liberation,
self-determination,
dignity, liberation,
self-determination,
dignity, liberation,
self-determination,
dignity, liberation,
self-determination.
When Muslims are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back.
When Muslims are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back.
When Arabs are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back.
When Arabs are under attack, what do we do?
Stand up, fight back.
The people united will never be defeated.
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 All right, thank you very much. So next up, I'd like to introduce the Executive Director of the Arab Resource and Organizing Center, Lara Kiswani. Please give her a hand.
Thank you all for coming out here today. While we're brought here for unfortunate circumstances, history has taught us that in these moments, these collective acts of solidarity and power, that we are able to build communities and counter shift tides and counter the most egregious and already targeted community in this country. In the last month alone, there have been over 60 reported hate crimes against the Arab and Muslim community. And these are only the ones we know about. People have been shot. They have been threatened. Their homes and places of worship have been attacked and vandalized. While most of the media attention has centered on the blatant racism of presidential candidate Donald Trump, we know that the words of Trump live within the conditions of society that repeat them, that act on them, and produce them. 9/11 taught us this. Japanese internment taught us this. Slavery has taught us this. Displacement and war has taught us this. And today we are here to say no more. We are here to say that we are people who resist these words and actions. We are people that resist discrimination, racist policies and practices. And we call on everyone to do the same. Our society cannot afford any more hate or racism, whether it is from a stranger on the street or the FBI, whether it is from Trump or the police, whether it is in the form of a hate crime or systemic surveillance, imprisonment, and warmongering. We must ask ourselves, why is it we find ourselves in this place time and time again? What are the systems and structures that need to change? What are the practices that we need to develop? What is the culture we need to cultivate? It is clear as day that the targeting of Arab and Muslims is by no means an accident. It is intended to instill fear, to justify racist policies that in turn further criminalize black and brown communities here and everywhere. This is what we saw, this is what we've seen with the war on terror that continues to devastate our communities worldwide. Just as people all over the world have raised their voices to stand with the Syrian refugees, just as people have expressed outrage at police, the police murders of black and brown youth, just as you all have come out here today, this Friday afternoon, to let the world know that we are not complicit in scapegoating and warmongering. Our people have always stood strong in the face of repression and racism. That is what we are doing here today, shoulder to shoulder with allies and targeted communities. While we face increased violence at the hands of individuals, we know we must rely on one another. We cannot rely on law enforcement to protect us. The FBI, the police, the state have played a central role in targeting and criminalizing Arabs and Muslims, just as they have with other people of color. So we must stand together to ensure our safety by building up the strength of our families and friends to protect one another, to develop resources, draw on lessons learned from collective efforts. Now is the time to empower people to challenge racism and take a stand. We must invest in our community. to turn a blind eye to the role of the U.S. government in fueling this racism. We are being told that we are not welcome at borders. We are being told that we must beg not to be imprisoned. We are being told that we must beg not to be attacked, not to be bombed, not to be surveilled. And here today, we are here to say that we choose not to beg. We choose to fight for one another. We choose to strengthen our will. We choose to deepen our commitment to dignity and self-determination. So let's continue to fight together for the sake of all our communities. Thank you.
Putting this on social media, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, you know, all of that, whatever ones I missed, make sure that you use the hashtag. Make sure you use the hashtag resist racism and the hashtag stand with Muslims to make sure that not just those who weren't able to make it in the Bay Area, but the folks outside of the Bay Area know that here we will not accept racism and xenophobia against our communities. Let the people know all around the country that the Bay Area has no tolerance for this kind of hate. So we work for the Arab Resource and Organizing Center, a center that works for immigration for our community. We also do youth work. And we recently were able to pass Arabic language pathways into SF Unified School District as well. And as been mentioned before, this type of Islamophobia has been seen before the recent San Bernardino attacks, before the recent Paris attacks. This has been happening in our community since the war on terror. And that even passing something something so simple to give our communities access as Arabic language into our schools was such an obstacle just to even get that passed. So I want to thank all of you who are in this space right now who helped us do that. Next up, I want to introduce Salah al-Bakri from the Yassin Foundation, a Muslim community leader. Please give a round of applause to Salah al-Bakri.
Thank you. I'm not used to reading from papers, so I'll try. I usually speak my heart. Community, we are outraged at the backlash our community is facing. There have been numerous hate crimes against innocent Muslims in the past week. Just last week, we had the care offices being sent envelopes with suspicious powder, and you had people with dressed up almost like spacecraft engineers surrounding the area, taking all their representatives to hospital for quarantining. Till for 2 days, the building was closed. There was firebombing in a mosque in Palm Springs, firebombing a Muslim-owned coffee shop after defacing it with Nazi signs in North Dakota, a Muslim boy being beaten to death and thrown from the sixth-story building in Seattle, who had absolutely nothing to do with extremist attacks. Our community members are complaining daily. They're texting me, they're sending me Facebook messages, and they're saying that they're facing harassment at school. I have so many students who have actually filed complaints against teachers for really feeling harassed and bullied in school. Now, that's really scary. It's one thing to be harassed by another child. It's another thing to be that level to go to a level of bullying. It's a third level to go where the master of the classroom is spreading things that are really hurtful to a child. We're seeing harassment in the streets, in the malls, and at the workplace. This goes against the values of civil rights, hate crimes against our fellow Americans of any faith, fear at the very fabric of this country. While emotions are running high, it's imperative for the survival and the safety of our beautiful communities that the voice of reason triumphs over the voice of intolerance. Muslims come from every corner of the earth. They come from every ethnicity and every profession. We have Muslim congressmen. We have executives of all corporations here. We have lawyers. We have janitors. We have merchants. We have white. We have black. We have brown. We have yellow. We have Salvadorians. We have Norwegians. We have Africans. We have Arabs. And we have Christians. And they're all coming from all walks of life. Now, how are you going to discriminate against them by just their look? How about if I tell you that a lot of other cultures besides the Muslim culture wear turbans and wear modest clothing? end up with. These are the definitions for you. I'm going to go ahead and give you a couple of definitions so as to put your mind and heart at ease, especially the media, because I keep on hearing definitions and words thrown around easily. So, to put your minds and hearts at ease, learn about Islam. Get the facts right. These are the definitions for you as given by the Prophet of Islam. Number one, Muslim. As narrated by the Prophet of Islam, he states, Muslim is a person whose humanity is safe from his tongue and hands. The second level, mu'min, believer. A believer is someone whose neighbor is safe from his ill deeds. Third one, Islam. Islam is a practice in living in security, physical, mental, and spiritual, by voluntarily surrendering one's will to the will of the Creator. Jihad, I might say that word for you, is the daily self-struggle with one's own self to do the right thing, to be pious, to be compassionate, to stop yourself from responding when you are angry, to force yourself to forgive when you're hurt, especially when the hurt is fresh and the cut is deep. Now that is jihad, self-struggle. I want to leave you with a couple of words because my time is up. German Lutheran pastor, I want to quote a German Lutheran pastor, a theologian, an anti-Nazi dissident, and key founding member in the Confessing Church, whose writing on Christianity's role in the secular world have become widely influential, once wrote, and I quote, his name is Friedrich Boehler. Silence, he says, and I quote, silence in the face of evil is itself evil. God will not hold us guiltless. Not to speak is to speak. Not to act is to act. And finally, I want to leave you with a verse from the Quran that really has been very misrepresented. Just for your information, the Quran has 15 verses, just 15 verses about war, much less than any other holy book, most of which is to regulate the rules of engagement. The Quran has, in exchange, 540 verses asking us to contemplate and think about the physical nature and the universe and wonder about the creation of the Lord. The Quran speaks, verse 62, and I quote, surely they that believe, and those of Jewry, meaning Jews, and the Christians, and those Sabaeans, whoso believes in God and the last day, so all of these people, the Jews, the Christians, and whoso believes in God and the last day, and work righteousness, their wage awaits them with their Lord, and no fear shall be on them, neither shall they sorrow. In other words, they will be in heaven. Now find me any other faith that believes that other faith followers will actually end up in heaven. I want to leave you with these words, not to act is to act, not to speak is to speak. God bless you all. Thank you.
For increasing the surveillance of all communities of color. That's what the war on terror is. It's not just a war on Islamic and Arab peoples, but it's a war on all peoples of color collectively through the justification of scapegoating Islam. So we're going to try something a little new.
Where's my,
hey.
Okay. Yeah.
We're going to try a new chant. So he's going to say the first one, I'm going to say the second piece. If y'all catch on, feel free to join. Everybody take a look, Trump is just another crook. Everybody take a look, Trump is just another crook. Everybody take a look, Trump is just another crook. Just like the ones before, feed the rich and rob the poor. Everybody take a look,
Trump is
just another crook. Just like the ones before, feed the rich and rob the poor. Everybody take a look. Trump is just another crook.
All right.
Just like the ones before, feed the rich and rob the poor. Everybody take a look. Trump is just another crook. Just like the ones before, feed the rich and rob the poor. for once before. All right, next up, I'd like to introduce to the mic Shahid Bazar, a community activist. Please put your hands together for Shahid. I'm very proud to be here today, and I particularly want to thank people from other faiths, and maybe I speak with, on behalf of all the Muslims here, for this in particular, your solidarity, and particularly your memory of what it means to be American. And I guess I just want to reiterate that. All of us here are American. I was born in the UK, but came to the States when I was two. My family located to rural Missouri, where, as very much a product of my environment, when I was 11, I apparently borrowed my dad's typewriter one night and attempted to write a letter to the U.S. Marine Corps enlisting to fight the commies. I've learned a great many things since then. And on the way to becoming a constitutional lawyer, I work at the Electronic Frontier Foundation, though my comments here today are very much on my own behalf and not on behalf of our organization. I'm very deeply aware that Muslims in the United States stand in a long line of proud Americans who have suffered abuses and indignities on behalf of the state. We shouldn't forget, of course, that African-American communities in our midst and in our country have been vilified and terrorized for hundreds of years. Even today as we speak, animal rights activists and earth rights activists are not only subjected to many of the same kinds of treatment as Muslim communities, including FBI infiltration and contrived prosecutions, but there's a whole other host of movements. The peace movement, the movement for equal rights for women went through this in the 70s. Puerto Rican independence movement, the American Indian movement. We are as Americans, we are more American for the fact of being targeted and subjected to unconstitutional abuses of our rights than we would be otherwise. And remember that the scapegoating of Muslims is worse than it might seem. And I'll put it this way, I am less concerned for our community than I am for America, because oppression moves by rotation. We are not the first, and we will not be the last. And more concerning to me than the subversion of our community's rights is the subversion of the promise of what it means to be American. And I'm very glad that you're all out here today to remind us what that means. What happened to me last week, and I would think that will never happen to me. And of course, I don't feel comfortable speaking in public. So. Thanks.
You're amazing!
And because we were faced, this lady approached us and started talking badly about the God Allah, which is the Arabic word for God. And she was talking, she said, Allah is Satan. You guys pray for the devil. You all are murderers, killers, terrorists. When we tried to be reasonable with her, we told her we believe in Jesus. We actually love Jesus. If you're a Muslim and you don't believe in Jesus, you're not even a Muslim. And then she just started getting louder. And she hit me with an umbrella and threw a coffee to my face. And when she was asked later, why did you do that? She was, she said, I was just protecting myself. I wasn't feeling safe. And I hope this will stop. And I hope people stop Trump overdosing and just take him out. Thank you so much.
Yes.